call on your name, you silence the shame. You hear me, you're with me. I know I'm not alone. I'm not alone.
Ooh, yeah. Ooh, yeah. Ooh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
the darkness or the shadow it casts. 'cause you take good care of me. You take good care of me. And you know what I need before I even ask a thing. And you hold me in your hands with a kindness that never ends. I'm carried in your love no matter what the future brings.
It's always the lie that is loudest. I know the one with the power is never the one who is shouting, shouting. I lean in, I know that I need to listen. Through all of the thunder you whisper, even in doubt you are with me, with me. Like a love song that I've always known, your word hits me deep inside my soul.
When you speak, in the sound of peace, be still. The wind and the waves bow to your will. You drown my fear with a love more real than anything, anything I feel. When you speak, when you speak,
I know you're not the god of confusion. Why do I feel like I'm losing my mind every time? I can't see what you're doing like a love song.
Well, how are you this morning? We're excited to be here. Are you excited to be here? Let's all please stand together, everybody. And welcome everybody online that's watching us right now. Thank you for joining us. I want to say that we miss you. Father in heaven, we are honored to be in your presence, Lord, and we offer this time to you, and we offer this service to you. We offer our lives to you. Lord, you are faithful, and you continue to be faithful throughout the ages, and you never stop, even when we are not faithful. Thank you for your faithfulness, God. We owe it all to you, to the work of Jesus on the cross, to his victory over death and sin. We owe it all to you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for fighting for us.
The Lord is in the fight, and we know how this ends. It will end how it started, with him in command. The Lord's in the fight.
This is a new song, everybody. We'll be right back.
battle that I face is riding with me. In the constant cloud by day and fire by night, he's already gone before me, and his grave's testifying that I have resurrection power on my side. The light is in the sky. The Lord is in the fight. When it feels like it's missing, oh, when it's always winning, don't you forget it. The Lord is in the fight. Oh, he fights for us. Don't ever give up. Never lose hope. Don't ever forget. He's in control. He's hearing the suffering. He's hearing the night. He's hearing the chaos. He's hearing the sigh. The Lord isn't worried. The Lord will not hide. The Lord is nice. Oh, the Lord is.
Forget, Lord.
Rumors are the Son of Man. Stories are the Savior. Holiness with human hands. Treasure for the traitor. No ear had heard, no eye had seen the image of the Father until heaven came to live with me. A rescue like no other. Yeah, you.
my ransom, my savior, my refuge, my hiding place. You're my helper, my healer, my blessed redeemer, my ensign, my saving grace. You're my hope in the shadow, my strength in the battle, my anchor for all my days. Yes, you are. Oh, yeah, you stand by my side. You stood in my place, Jesus. No other name.
I've been held in your hands.
together, church. God is good all the time. Our God is good. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. We sing, worthy is your name. You're faithful, Lord. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Praise. We go on and on and on throughout the ages, God, and it would never stop. You are King, the Lamb who went to the cross, who died for our sins, who rose victorious, and
now King forever. We bow before you, Lord. We worship you. You are good. You are faithful. Lord, you're merciful. Lord, you are righteous. And your ways are perfect. I'll give you praise. Amen. Please say hi to somebody next to you.
Good morning. How y'all doing? Thanks again for joining us online. We very much appreciate you. And for those of you out on the patio or courtyard area, thanks again for coming out and joining us. We do have a few things we'd like to talk about. And ladies, the first one is directed towards you. This Saturday, June the 12th at 8 a.m., it's a fun four-mile hike that the ladies will be going on. Be up at Santa Rosa Plateau. And if you haven't been up there, it's a beautiful place to hike. The trails are pretty wide and nice. It's 8 a.m. sharp. If you go directly to our website, it will give you the specific location where the ladies will meet. And there is a $4 entrance fee to get into the plateau unless you're already a member. So please bring that with you. Be ready for that. And then next, for those of you who'd like to participate in our blood drive, we are partnering with Livestream Blood Bank again, and that's going to be Sunday, June the 27th. We'll be in the gym, and we're going to be meeting from 7 a.m. to 1. And you do need to sign up online, and so if you'll go to our website and get signed up, that would be great. And that way, they'll know exactly when you're coming, and they'll assign a time to come for that. And then we do have a rummage sale coming up, trying to support our missionaries that are in Bulgaria. The Laster family. So we're looking or asking you to bring, I like what it says here, lightly used items. So please bring stuff that could be donated that they could resell. And so that would be next Sunday. That's not true. It would be the following Sunday, June the 20th from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. So on the June the 20th, if you could bring some items, we'll be dropping them on the lower campus and they'll be storing them there. And then we'll give you some more details. If you are a buyer of those treasures, it would be the following weekend for that. And we'll give you that information as it comes around. But first, if you could donate, then we'll let you know how to repurchase those items. And then we do have some job opportunities. And so on our website, we have a link on our website kind of at the bottom of the page that says job opportunities. And we'd like to just mention two of them today. And the positions are ministry support and then an audiovisual tech. And so we need some help around here helping support our ministry setup and tear down and some other things. So that's what our ministry support will be and then our audio tech. But the description will be listed there. So if you're interested in that, please apply and go directly online. Thanks.
I met a little girl last week out in the courtyard out there, and she said, "Hi, Pastor Larry." I said, "Hey, how are you?" I just started talking with her. That's right. I like so far, we've said, we want your blood, and we want your stuff, and then we'll sell it back to you the following weekend. So far, so good. We're good at marketing and, Hey, but we do have an Israel trip. Right after third service, I'm going to be doing an informational meeting right over in the Agape room. And I would see it this way. If you want, it's for an investment of 2 years of Bible college to put down to a two-week, mini-week course when we go over there. There's just so much learning. We absolutely have a blast. Our last team, we had, I think, 54, and so we all fit on one bus, and we're together the whole time. Our guide is incredible, the amount of teaching and training that they have to go through to know everything about Judaism, to know everything about Islam, to know everything about Christianity. These guys are just so sharp, all the different wars and flora and fauna and just everything, and so all the way just traveling on they have very nice buses that we travel on, and there's just constantly questions going around trying to learn it, but you really see the country, and there isn't a place in Scripture that you read where you weren't standing right there or know the distance when we drove from here to there to be able to get to it, and so it's really a great educational tour, and so that'll be right after third service at 1:30 this afternoon if you want to come back for that, and we'll be over in the Agape room. And then tonight we have our prayer night at 6:30 to 7:30, so 1 hour of prayer. You can join me again, same thing over in the Agape room, and love to have you with us as we just pray through different topics, and it's always neat to see what the Lord's going to do with prayer, and it just sends his presence during that time. So allow me to pray, and then we're going to jump back into Exodus chapter 12. Lord, as we continue to talk about your son Jesus as that Passover lamb, that unblemished and innocent little lamb that gave its life, that shed its blood, that we might be forgiven of our sins. And so we thank you for the imagery that you give us here. We pray, God, that you would help us walk through how we learn and what we learn about the Passover event to see how it relates to the Lord's Supper today, and how we make the connection between one and the other. And so help us with that as we learn through that. And we also thank you for the ability at the end of our service to be able to have a communion. And so we, Lord, just sense your presence in our time of worshiping you in song, but now also as we get into your word, and then also with the cherry on top, being able to have communion together with our brothers and sisters as we just continue to worship you. We love you, God, and just pray that you'd speak to us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you make your way on over to Exodus chapter 12. Entitled it, The Walk of Freedom. You know, remembrance, as we think back on something in our lives, remembrance plays a powerful role in our spiritual journey. The Bible has a lot to say on remember this. Set up a stone here, and every time you see that stone, you're going to remember what happened here with the crossing of the Jordan or whatever it was. But it plays a powerful role in our spiritual journey. If we regularly remember and commemorate our own spiritual deliverance, we'll relish the freedom in which we now walk. And so it's good to think back on the day of your salvation and how you got saved and what friends or family members it was that was talking with you about accepting the Lord and what that meant. And so we think of freedom. Our country has the Freedom Trail over in Boston. Today we commemorate D-Day, where the Battle of Normandy resulted in the Allied liberation of Western Europe from Nazi Germany's control. We had Nelson Mandela's autobiography, The Long Walk to Freedom. And our church participates every year in the anti-human trafficking group called A21, their Walk for Freedom, right over here in Temecula. And here in Exodus 12, we remember the beginning of Israel's walk of freedom. And so truly, as this book is called the Book of Exodus, we finally get to the place where we have the Exodus, where they're exodusing, all right? And so we're going to pick it up in verse 29 in chapter 12. But the study of the Passover enriches our understanding of the Lord's Supper. So you might think, why do we have to study this history? What does it help us to be able to go back and remember Passover? Well, even in our having of communion today, and that's why I love the timing of how it worked out from last week. We started talking about the Passover lamb, and the importance of that, how Jesus would come and become that. But now we can connect all the dots to the Lord's Supper today and what was happening during that time and all the connections. And so hopefully you have you got the communion when you came in. I'm going to read to you a meme my daughter had sent me after last communion that we had. It shows the little communion cups that we have, and it says this: "We'll know COVID is over when we no longer take styrofoam and Robitussin as communion elements." And so I hope you can find the humor in that. But anyways, they're nice and packaged well and safe for us. But anyways, to fully live for our deliverer, we must always remember our deliverance. To fully live for our deliverer, we must always remember our deliverance. Let's pick it up in verse 29, and I'll just take it in small portions this morning. We'll look at Pharaoh's surrender. 29 through 32. "At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn." So this is the 10th and final plague. "At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. From the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and the firstborn of the livestock. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where someone was not dead. And then he summoned Moses and Aaron by night and said, "Up, go out from among my people, both you and all the people of Israel, and go serve the Lord as you have said. Take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also." Interesting. Finally humbled by this God. Not saying that Pharaoh's getting saved here, but there's this aspect of no more plagues. You win, and can you even ask a blessing for me at the end of it? Doesn't give us more detail than what all was going on in his mind, but something has changed. And so we see a vivid reminder of the fury of God against sinners and the awful price that sin exacts. And if you weren't here last week, we had talked about that God had ramped up each of these different plagues, making each one worse. And finally, the ninth one with darkness for 3 solid days where you couldn't even see somebody else in your house. And now this one with the death of the firstborn. Desiring for all to be able to repent and come to him and know that he is the one and true and living God. But they wouldn't be there. What's interesting about verse 29 here, one verse. The Torah spends several verses. We've talked a lot about the Passover sacrifice, this whole chapter. But only one verse on the killing of the firstborn. Maybe the 10th plague is just too painful to relate, to be able to talk about. As the Egyptians too are God's creatures. And many of the firstborn are innocents. And so it's just a tough story to tell. And so one verse is given over to the death of the firstborn. Matter of fact, despite centuries of the Egyptians' oppression of the Hebrews, one of the Torah's 613 laws. So out of the first 5 books of the Bible, the Jews came up with 613 laws. And one of those actually prohibit the hating of the Egyptians. It's in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 7. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we identify a monster in our life or in, you know, somebody close to our family or whatever else, and we want to so demonize them. Let me give you an example. When we were in Cambodia working with AIM, and there we were in Saipak, Kelly and I, and we had a team of about, I don't know, 10 or 12 of us, and we were talking with them, and they were showing us all the things that they had. Now, Saipak had been the pedophile capital of the world, is what it was called, and they had moved in there. They'd been there about 15 years now, and as they were there, they're talking about, well, as you're talking about children being pimped out at age 9 and just hearing these horrific things, there's something that just wells up inside of you of justice and everything else where you just want these pimps damned. And then they said, and there's right across the street is what we call God's gym or the Lord's gym. And in that, a lot of pimps in the area come there, and we have number 2 and number 3 Muay Thai boxer guys, you know, martial arts guys that work out there, and so they're highly respected, and they look up to them, and we're seeing even some of the pimps come to know Christ. And it's that reminder in you of, oh yeah, they need to be saved too, instead of just jailed or shot or whatever else that your mind is thinking. It's that constant reminder that they're struggling with their own demons. They're dealing with, they're just lost in a different way. And with that, we need to be praying for their salvations also. And so the Lord pauses in Deuteronomy 23:7 and says, hey, don't hate them. Don't hate them. Pretty powerful. In verse 31, Pharaoh finally comes to the place and says, go serve the Lord. Not just get out of our country, but he had heard during these 10 plagues, he's been hearing what they were saying. Our God has called us to go serve him. Okay, go, but not without all the kids. No, our kids got to go too. Okay, go, but not with all the flocks. No, we need those for the sacrificing of our God. They knew it was all about worshiping of God. So this is the real issue, to go and serve the Lord. And this reminds us of the centrality of corporate worship. Not just some of them going, but we're going to all go together. And God was demanding that. how important that was to the Lord, all going together to worship. This past year, we've experienced the importance of corporate worship during this time of a pandemic. We can get by with online worship, that's for sure, for a time. But eventually, the lack of face-to-face worship destroys the sense of community of our historical community. Matter of fact, it is said that Voltaire said this. I was trying to find it. I couldn't find it. But he spoke prophetically when he said, if you want to destroy Christianity, you must abolish Sunday. I'll tell you what, there's a meeting with our board during the early time of COVID. It's just like, what the heck is church going to look like? Is it going to exist? Will people come back? How many years will it be before that takes place? And just the anxiety and the angst over all of what was going to happen with all of that. And what we've watched week after week after week of folks coming back, old friends, old faces, and we'd see them. And at the beginning of the service, they'd say, this is our first time back since the beginning of COVID. We welcomed them back. And at the end, they're almost in tears saying, oh my gosh, I didn't realize how much we missed it. And I said, I know. I was sitting, you know, for the weeks that I was at home too, and sitting there and would kind of, after we had filmed our online thing and going and at home with Kelly and I, and we're just trying to do church at home, and it's just like, I can't sing out loud in my house like that. It's just like I can sing with others, and we're doing that. Like, I can never start a song on in tune. I can sing in tune with somebody singing with me, but to do that, it's just so strange, and I think that's what you, as you come back, you don't know what you're missing until you know you're missing it. And so you come back and it's just like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize how special it was to be able to gather together with the brethren. So let me speak to our friends online just for a second, okay? We miss you. And we miss your spiritual gifts here at Calvary Murrieta. And we miss the part that you specifically play that God himself has given to you. Paul said, every part does its share, and it makes the whole body fit together perfectly. Again, he says, and each part does its own special work, and it helps the other parts grow, so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. That's in Ephesians 4:16. And it talks about this gifting that he gives every single one of us, that we're like a giant puzzle pieces, and we still have puzzle pieces that are missing, and we need you, and we say, come back when you can. If you're staying home, we'll say it one more time. If you're staying home for your health, then stay home. That's important to do. But if you just got comfortable staying home, get on back here. We miss you. Okay? Do you see me looking into the camera? Okay, good. We miss you. Come on back. All right. I just wanted to share that. Let's read our next section. Reparations for slavery, verse 33 through 36. The Egyptians were urgent with the people to send them out of the land in haste. For they said, we shall all be dead. They don't know what this angel of death is all about, killing the firstborn. Are they going to come back through and take all of us? They just want the Israelites out of there. Verse 34. So the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading bowls being bound up and their cloaks on their shoulders. The people of Israel had also done as Moses told them, for they had asked the Egyptians for silver and gold jewelry and for clothing. And the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And so that they let them have what they asked. Thus they plundered the Egyptians. I don't have a whole lot to say about this, but it seems like it's reparations here. And as I put on the screen behind me, the reparations, making amends for a wrong one has done. This is 430 years of working for free for the Pharaoh, for the Egyptians. And so with this, maybe this was simply their wages for the last 400 plus years of servitude of why this is placed there. Now, again, we'll talk later on of this gold and silver and why it was needed. They're going to use it in the Lord's tabernacle. They'll be able to give out of generosity or keep it for themselves. And so they'll work through that when we get a little bit further down. Road trip, verse 37 through 42. And the people of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth. And so this very verse right here in verse 37, this becomes the Exodus. They're finally leaving. They've been living in Ramses, or it's also called Goshen, and they're heading to Succoth, which we really don't believe is a place, because Sukkot in the Hebrew is the Feast of Tabernacles, or when they would prop up little tents and they would stay outside and remember this very event that's right here. So they're moving from here out into the wilderness somewhere and setting up tent site. That's kind of their tent community for a time. About 600,000 men on foot, besides women and children. Then it says a mixed multitude, other foreigners that were there in the land, maybe even some of the Egyptians following with them, wanting to, maybe they fell in love with this God of Israel, we don't know. But a mixed multitude also went up with them, and very much livestock, both flocks and herds. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough that they had brought out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not wait, nor had they prepared any provisions for themselves. Let me just pause and say, this unleavened bread isn't the unleavened bread for the Passover. They've already eaten the Passover, but again, this is just a make haste. They don't have time for the dough to rise. They're just going to bake what they can because they have to get out that evening. Verse 40 gives us the time period. The time that the people of Israel lived in Egypt was 430 years. At the end of the 430 years, on that very day, all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. It was a night of watching by the Lord to bring them out of the land of Egypt. And so this same night is a night of watching kept to the Lord by all the people of Israel throughout their generations. So the very first Passover here, the very first exodus of them taking off here is, again, this night of watching by the Lord. But they're to commemorate it by using that night as a kind of a vigil to the Lord beyond that. The Israelites spend their final night in Egypt in extreme watchfulness. They're likely worried about retaliation by Pharaoh. Again, even today when the Jews hold their Seder feast, on that Passover feast, as they do that, they do two things. A lot of times they'll open the front door and they'll have a place setting for Elijah, because before Messiah returns, Elijah will show up. And so that's what they do to show their watchfulness. And so they commemorate that still every single year, this watchfulness that we're talking about here. Of course, Jesus talks about that, if you'll believe it, Elijah has already come in John the Baptist, and kind of talks about, again, one of those prophecies that it's already happening and will still happen in the future with Elijah coming back. Today, in 1 Corinthians 6, 13, we're to be watchful also. Matter of fact, as Paul's wrapping up his first letter to the Corinthians, he says, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. And it's a great kind of commission right towards the very end of his first epistle there. But I like that. He's kind of saying the same thing, that you and I, we're to be watchful also for the second return of Christ. It's that word, that watchful is Gregorio. And so if your name's Greg or Gregory, that's what it means, to be alert and be watchful. And it's the reminder to all the Gregories in the room that, hey, that's what your life's all about, of being watchful and waiting for the Lord to return. But actually, it's all for all of us, not just the Gregs. I was looking at Greg over there. All right. A few lessons so far. Though we move ahead into freedom, we're to never forget what God has done in the past. What a great reminder that is right there. Would you define your life as slavery or freedom? Egypt or promised land? As you think about your life today. Thirdly, never forget, always remember, and dream forward. Live in a perpetual state of readiness to respond to God's special call on our lives as they were that evening. They're ready to go as soon as the Lord says go. And lastly, are you willing and ready to move from the familiar to the unfamiliar? That had to be the hardest. And maybe God's putting on your heart and your family, and you guys are praying through moving out of state like everybody else is, you know, maybe something like that, or maybe just moving, or, you know, whatever it is. But with that, that's hard. These 430 years, that's generations. That's all they know is Egypt. That's all they know is Goshen. That's all they know is the Delta of the Nile. That's where they lived. They only know slavery. They only know this. And yes, freedom is a great thing, but what's on the other side? And is Pharaoh going to chase us down? Are we going to die in the wilderness? They don't know. It's all this future stuff that gets really scary. Are you willing and ready to move from the familiar to the unfamiliar and whatever God's calling that to? Maybe it's a job change. Maybe it's a school change, whatever it is. Maybe it's a major change in college, and you know, whatever it is, that's not easy. And so with that, yeah, there's going to be a lot of complaining on their part, as you probably know most of the story and what happens there in the wilderness and that. But they have to think back, wait, didn't we have it better back there? And you know, all those things going through their minds, just as we would deal with today, moving from the familiar to the unfamiliar. The Passover revisited in 43 through 51. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "This is the statute of the Passover." Now, the Passover's happened, but this is kind of, so it's a little bit redundant, but it needs to add just a couple things of those that would be ineligible in the future Passovers to partake in them. This is the statute of the Passover. No foreigner shall eat it, but every slave that is bought for money may eat of it after you have circumcised him. No foreigner or hired worker may eat of it. It shall be eaten in one house. You shall not take any of the flesh outside the house. Shall not break any of its bones. We talked about that last week. That's why Jesus' bones weren't broken when he was on the cross. They stabbed him with a spear just to make sure that he was dead. That comes from this scripture here because he is our Passover lamb. Verse 47, and all the congregation of Israel shall keep it, keep the Passover. If a stranger shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover to the Lord, let all the males be circumcised. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native of the land. But no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. There shall be one law for the native and one for the stranger who sojourns among you. So one law for everybody. All the people of Israel did just as the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron. And on that very day, the Lord brought the people of Israel out of the land of Egypt by their host. The very day. Interesting how God's strategy and all of that, 430 years, but to the day, that's when God says, you're released, freedom. Again, just showing his that he's overseeing all of this and in control of all of this. We're going to take and kind of move this to the New Testament now. We've read it all last week and this week, all of chapter 12. The Passover's over now, and we're going to move towards that communion area. But a few things that I want to talk about first. Remember, John the Baptist is on the scene. He's got a couple of his disciples with him. He sees Jesus, and he actually did this twice. But he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. I think what he was saying then was, I get it. I finally get it now. Our firstborn were saved, thinking about his ancestors, looking back, because God gave up his firstborn. That's why us putting the blood over the top and the sides of our door, that's what our forefathers had done, that's what was happening. The only reason our firstborn were saved is because God's firstborn was given up, sacrificed. He was that lamb. This was the answer to Abraham, where God basically said, I'm going to walk up the mountain with my son and place the wood on him, and nobody's going to be there to be able to say stop, as he did with Abraham and Isaac. Abraham gets the pleasure to hear that word stop before he slices the throat of his son Isaac. How far would Abraham go? It's a faith test, as you know. But God the Father is saying, there's no one going to be telling me to stop. I have to let it go. It's got to go all the way through. He has to die. He is my sacrifice. One commentator put it this way, when the ultimate child cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? The Father paid the price in his silence. When John said, behold, the Lamb of God, he wasn't just saying, there he is. No, it was behold. Think about it. Take it in. Realize it. Look, look, look. Grasp it. Here's what's happening. There's the Passover lamb. As we look through four main chapters in the Bible, there's Abraham's chapter of the lamb saying that basically there's a debt, a sacrifice needs to be made with that whole illustration with him and his son Isaac. Then Moses' chapter of the lamb here, that the lamb is a substitute when we think of this Passover lamb. A substitute has to pay for the penalty. And then Jesus' chapter of the lamb where he said, it's me. He shows up in the New Testament saying, I'm the lamb, God's son. Lord's Supper made that clear. And there's one more chapter to come where the lamb is on the throne. Book of Revelation 7:17. For the lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he'll guide them. It's funny that a lamb is the shepherd, but that's what it says. And he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And so that's the final chapter about this lamb, as we said, which is the story kind of weaved all the way through Scripture. I'm going to turn to another place. I'm going to turn to the New Testament. I'm going to turn to Luke chapter 22, where Jesus has taken verses 18 through 13 and having a few of his disciples go set up the Passover. And so they set up this whole entire Passover, and again, where he turns this into the Lord's Supper. And so as you see behind me there, I'll just read this portion. When the hour came, he reclined at the table and the apostles with them, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Some say, I don't know if this is really a Passover as they look at the Lord's Supper and what he was doing here. With Luke's account, you can't say that. Again, since verse 8, he told them exactly what to do, how to set it up, and they say, well, but the lamb is never mentioned, and that has to be part of the Sabbath. The supper here, but he had specifically, no, he calls it the Passover. I earnestly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I'll tell you, I will not eat it until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he gave thanks, he said, take this, divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, the cup, after he had eaten, saying, this cup is poured out for you. It's the new covenant of my blood. It's a couple of things that he says here. I'm not going to eat it until we do it together in the kingdom. We're not going to drink this other cup until we do it together in the kingdom. What's happening here is at the Passover sacrifice, the focal point was the lamb on the table. But here we have at the Lord's Supper, the focal point is the lamb at the table. Not on the table, but at the table, the one leading all of this. As Israel looked back to the Exodus through the Passover meal, so we, the New Testament saints, look back to the cross and the resurrection through the Lord's Supper. Do this in remembrance of me. And so we're to think back to the cross and his resurrection. In the Passover, the Jews remember and proclaim their redemption from Egypt. In the Lord's Supper, believers remember and proclaim their redemption from sin. It's the new Exodus. It's the new Exodus from the flesh and the world and the devil. And the Lord's Supper here then, Luke kind of gives us four reasons for it. Number one, it tells us that it's rooted in redemption. The Passover, it's rooted in that, from slavery to freedom. And so understand what was happening back there. Remember what was happening back there so you'll understand what's happening here. It's just a new kind of freedom. Freedom from yourself, freedom from your sin, freedom from this world. It's also planned by Jesus, and it meticulously was. The host rejoices at your presence. Anytime and every time that we do communion. You might sometimes see communion as, oh, we're doing that again. Oh yeah, that's right, it's the first Sunday of the month, we're doing that again. But that's not how he sees it. He enjoys when you come to his table. Matter of fact, I love I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you. If I remember right, and I meant to look this up, but that earnestly desired is I lust after. We always think of lust in the negative. I am so craving it with every part of my being to do this with you. That's what he was saying there. And so he rejoices your presence at his table. Thirdly, it anticipates the future. Twice he talks about One day we're going to eat together in the kingdom. One day we're going to drink together in the kingdom. This, see, the promise of a feast that'll be fulfilled later. This is only the beginning of it now, but it'll be fulfilled later. Fulfilled later starts now. This little tiny fragment of bread that you and I eat, the little sippy cup that we have of the juice that we drink here, as we receive the Lord's Supper. Look at it this way. It's kind of like it's the first course of a splendid eternal feast. It's the appetizer to what is to come. It's how he's saying that, and it's how we see it in so many different places. And it's each time we take it then, but it's such a small amount. This isn't like a meal, right? But it's just to kind of whet our appetite. It's just to remind us each and every time what is to come, of one day sitting down and feasting with him. At its source in northern Minnesota, the Mississippi River is an unimpressive little stream that you can literally wade in. But even at that point, it's the real thing, the actual Mississippi. And it's the same with the bread and the cup. It's the actual thing. It's part of that feast to come. And lastly, it recalls Jesus' substitutionary death when he says, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." It's about me and my redemption is what Jesus is saying there. But it's also given for you, which speaks to his unique, once and for all, fully sufficient substitutionary death given for you. This is what it will take for you to be forgiven of your sins. I'm willingly laying down my life for you. So we note at this table, many things on this table, as we know from still the Seder feast today that the Jews still enjoy. He doesn't take of the Passover lamb, because he's not going to use that as symbolism, because he's the symbolism of that Passover lamb, but instead chooses the bread off the table and the wine off the table. And he's instituting a feast, not a sacrifice, because he is the sacrifice. He's talking about this feast that we start now, but will be fulfilled later. 1 Corinthians 5, 7 and 8. "For indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us." Listen to sacrifice and feast. "Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, not with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." You hear that? And so he's saying, I'm the sacrifice. This is a feast. That's the change. A lamb being sacrificed. That's every year what happens at the Seder and continues to happen that way. But what he shifts this to in this reminder and remember me and do this remembrance of me is a feasting that is to take place. Do this in remembrance of me. Normally, we celebrate somebody's birthday and not their death day. Death days are hard to remember. My mom's death day is coming up next week. And so with that, those are hard days when we have those etched on our minds on the calendar of our mother or father or brother or sister or close friend that has died. They're hard to remember. And so he says, "I want you to remember my death day." Not his birthday. We do. We celebrate that at Christmas, right? But what he asked us to do is to celebrate his death day. Why? Or what? What do we remember about it? Maybe that he was truly a good man, a great Savior, a loving friend, a living hope, and a coming Lord. How does the Lord's Supper help us to remember him? It makes us come to a pause in our pilgrimage. This is, think of communion as slamming on the brakes of all of life. Just stop, right? And let's just think on him. All the busyness out of our minds and just pause. Pause in the midst of our pilgrimage. Secondly, it gives us a graphic picture of our salvation. Wow, what a price on my sin of what he had to go through. How ugly sin is. It reminds us of the reassuring promise of his grace. It remains clear prophecy of the future. I encourage you this morning to trust God's Passover sacrifice for you. That's Jesus. As we move into our communion time, If you trust God's Passover sacrifice for you, what we've been talking about, you'll be passed over from the judgment. No longer judgment hanging over you like a dark shadow. Sins forgiven, eternity with him. Just simply say, Jesus, be my Passover lamb. And so if you've never received Christ, that's what you simply ask him. Be my Passover lamb. And he'll pass over your sins also. Receive it in faith and have an attitude of surrender and repentance, and you are welcome to join him at his communion table. And so we're going to move into our communion time. If you'll get out the bread and the cup, if you'll just strip back just the top layer and get the bread. That's kind of the hard one to do, but be able to get our bread ready. When Paul was talking about communion, he said, make sure that you examine yourself. Think through what sins you need to confess before him. And I put it behind me there. I don't know if you can read it on the bottom, though. It's not proper English, but I think it's profound. Can you be more bad than God is good? Can you be more bad than God is good? And that's a lot of times a sticking point for us. But let's remember, you can only sin as a man, but God can forgive as a God. You sin as a finite creature, but the Lord forgives as an infinite creator. Confess your sin to him. Jeremiah said, for I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. He broke it and he gave it to them. And we see in the top right there, the bread broken is Christ for us. And then bread eaten is Christ in us. And bread partaken together is Christ among us. Father, as we hold this bread in our hand, we ask for your forgiveness of our sins. We take a moment now just to be quiet and to confess those before you so that you help us to just bring them to our mind. Let's do that now. God, we just confess before you so many things that we've done, so many words that we've spoken where they just chopped people in half. Thoughts in our minds that we confess before you. God, we desire to be cleansed and clean from all of our sins. We thank you what your son Jesus did for us on that cross. We thank you for being our substitution, paying a price that we could never pay. And so we hold this bread in our hands and we say, thank you, Jesus, for being that bread from heaven. That has come down to sustain us. Thank you for the forgiveness of our sins. Let's partake together. With the cup, the Passover requires 4 cups of wine, 2 before the meal, 2 after the meal. The cup of sanctification, the cup of rescue, the cup of redemption, and the cup of praise. The 4 cups represent the 4 expressions of deliverance promised by God. And we read it back in Ephesians 6, verse 6 and 7. It mentions those 4. The cup of wine that would have been raised during the Lord's Supper was that cup of redemption. So out of the 4, when he says to take the cup, it was during that 3rd cup, the cup of redemption, because he was there to redeem them. This was when Jesus established the new covenant of his blood. And it also says that they gave thanks. Thanksgiving is the expression of joy Godward. I like that. Thanksgiving is the expression of joy Godward. And believers are encouraged to abound in thanksgiving. And so now we take the cup. Lord, we hold this cup of redemption and we thank you, Lord, for your blood shed for us. And we give you thanks, Lord, just realizing we couldn't have done it on our own. We couldn't have done enough good deeds to make up for our bad deeds. We needed someone to take our place. We needed a redeemer. We needed someone to sacrifice for us, to pay a price we could never pay. We say thank you so much for our salvation. We love you. Let's partake together. Thank you, God. Thank you for these reminders. Lord, we see how healthy it is sometimes to look back. There's definitely some areas in our lives where we don't need to relive. They're dangerous. Dangerous for our minds, dangerous for our hearts, dangerous for our emotions. But there's other things, Lord, you call us. You look back and you remember this. And so, Lord, we do this in remembrance of you. Thank you for all that you have done for us. We love you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people stood and said amen. Let's all stand for our last song.
Forgive death to death and life for me. I quoted in the very beginning, to fully live for our deliverer, we must always remember his deliverance. Something to always look back on and always thank him for. Whenever you think of that word thankfulness and you start, what should I be thankful for? We can always start there. That's ground zero. We can always start there for all that he's done. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday, and just pray the Lord's blessings upon each of your lives. God bless you.
I spend my life chasing after. Is my story gonna have the same two words in every chapter?